I've done a lot of tutorials recently about how to, you know, use your character, move your character, that kind of stuff. But let's do a video about how to interact with the world. Let's talk about buttons. In VR, this is going to be one of the most basic go-to ways that the player is going to interact with your world. You want to be able to press a button. You want to have a console with a whole bunch of different things on it, all that kind of stuff. So today we're going to talk about how to do a normal physics-based push button. So without further ado, let's jump into it. Out of like the other videos where we completely start from scratch, I'm actually going to copy and paste one of the old tutorial videos that I did about the physics hands. So I'm just going to copy and paste that into this folder and rename it to physics button. And now I can open up Unity and we're going to add a new project, and then we're going to find that project, physics button, select the folder and select the new version that I just downloaded, confirm. And this is going to put us right where we left off with the physics-based hands tutorial. So if you have not seen that video, check that out up here. I'll link it just so you can get caught up to speed and then catch up with us here. Now, when you first load it up, it's not going to load on the correct scene. So we're going to click on scenes and click on the sample scene. And that's going to bring us into where we left off with this table and grabbable cube. We're just going to go ahead and delete both of these. Won't be needing that. And then I've also noticed that you need to do one thing in the project settings just to update it to the newest version. Just go into XR plugin management, click on this little exclamation point next to open XR, and then click fix all. And that'll fix any issues from the last version to the new version. So I'm going to go in here and create a 3D cube object, set the transform back to zero. And this is going to be a pedestal for our button to sit on.
How do you spell pedestal?
And I'm just going to resize this so it looks like a actual pedestal, you know? And then let's grab that blue material and make the pedestal blue. All right, now let's make button. So we're gonna make a new empty game object. We're gonna call this one button. And then inside of the button, we're gonna create another 3D object. And this one's going to be a cylinder. And we're gonna scale this one down. Try not to move it on the X, Y, or Z axis, just on the scale. We're gonna move the entire button with the parent button game object. So make sure everything else underneath it is set to a zero position rotation. So if you need to reposition, just go back out to your parent button and reposition it. And this is gonna be the base. So we're going to rename it to base. And this base comes with a capsule collider, but we're actually going to remove that. And then we're going to add a mesh collider and set the convex to true. And then we're also going to add a rigid body. And we're going to set this one to is kinematic just so that it doesn't move around while we're hitting it with physics. All right, now we're going to make a new game object inside of button. And this is going to be called push. Make sure the transform is set to zero. And then we're going to go back out to the base, press Control D to duplicate it, and then put it inside of this push game object. And then we're going to rename this new base to clicker. And the clicker is just going to be the visual part of the button. So we're going to remove the rigid body, remove the mesh collider, and we're going to scale it down just a little bit and then go back out to push. And you can move the push game object up so it looks like a button. And then we're going to take this other material and drop that on the button. And I'm actually going to turn it into like a red color. That looks better. So now we have a little button object. But right now, if we were to try to push it, nothing would happen. We need to do a few more things onto this push game object. First, we're going to add a box collider and scale this down 0.1, 0.1, 0.1, scale it down a little more, just enough so it covers most of the surface area of the pushable part of the button. And if you want to get super detailed with it, you can add another smaller box collider inside of these little areas here, but for the purposes of this tutorial, it's totally fine. You can mess around with different kinds of colliders here. I'm just going to use a box collider because it's easy. Now we're going to add a configurable joint. And this is what's going to join the base to the top and allow the spring action when you press down the button. So let's go through this bit by bit. A configurable joint will actually mimic any of the other kind of joints. So springs or hinges or anything like that. You can mimic each one of those joints from the configurable joint. And we might have been able to use a spring joint with this or a slide joint or something like that, but we're just going to do configurable because that's the one I know how to do it with. This connected body is going to be the base, and the base has to have a rigid body in order to go here. The anchor, we're going to auto connect it, and then each one of these motion and angular motion values we're going to set to locked, except for the Y motion. The Y motion is going to be limited. Everything else is locked. This will allow us to move the push part of the button up and down in a limited range, and that way it can't get pushed all the way through the base, and it can't be released up above and give us some weird behavior. And then linear limit is how far the button can get pushed down, and we're going to do a small amount, like 0.015 or something like that. We can adjust this later. And then last thing inside of this configurable joint is the Y drive. We're going to set the spring to 50, and we're going to set the dampener to 10. And so this will be the velocity that it bounces back up with, and the dampener is preventing that kind of springiness at the top. Let's go back to the rigid body. We're going to want to uncheck use gravity, and then for constraints, we want to freeze all of the rotations. The configurable joint also helps with this, but we're never going to want to move the X, Y, or Z, so we're going to freeze all of those. And everything else here is fine as it is. And now, if you were to play, I'm just going to switch back into scene view with the game playing, and you'll see that the button will bounce up and down. And if you wanted to play with the threshold, you go back into rigid body and click use gravity. That'll push it down to the minimum, and then you can adjust it using the linear limit. And so you can set the bottom limit of the button here, and I'm just going to keep it at 0.015 because that's a pretty good spot. So we've got the actual physics of the button working correctly. Now we just need to make it actually trigger an event whenever we press. So to do that, we're going to need to make a custom script. I'm going to call this physics button. Let's start by adding some events. We want a on pressed and an on released event. This is going to be public unity event on press. And then we can do two in the same line by adding a comma, type in on released. Unity event will need to be added with a using statement. So with my IDE, I can alt enter and it'll give me suggestions. If you're using Visual Studio, you can press control period. That'll give you some suggestions, or you can just type in this using statement using unityengine.events here at the top. Let's add a couple configurable variables. These will be serialized field and private. We want a threshold value. So this is going to be a float threshold. And we're going to set this to about 0.1 float. This value you can set in the editor because of the serialized field portion. And it's going to be the percentage of the button press that is going to be needed to activate the button. And then we're going to make another serialized field, also a float. And this is going to be a dead zone. I'm going to set this to 0.25 float. And this, like with any joystick controller, it's a dead zone in the middle where if there's any kind of bounciness there at the end, it's not going to press and release the button a whole bunch of times. So this is just to prevent any of that. And then we're going to want three private variables. We want a private bool is pressed. We're going to want a private vector 3 start position, and then a private configurable joint. And we're going to call this one joint. IsPressed is going to keep track of if the button has already been pressed. So that way we don't send the onPressed or onReleased event over and over and over again every frame. It's only going to happen once. So this is basically our state management. The startPosition is going to help us compare the startPosition to the current position to tell how far the button has moved. And then the configurable joint is obviously the joint, and we're going to get the linear limit from that. Let's go into the start method. We're going to set our startPosition equal to the transform.localPosition. It's important you use localPosition and not the .position because those are two different things. And then let's set our joint. That's going to be equal to get component configurable joint. All right. In the update method, this is where we're going to determine when we're going to call the onPressed and onReleased methods. So let's actually create those methods first. So these are the two methods we want to call when the button is pressed or released. Inside of these, we're going to want to set the isPressed variable, and then we're also going to want to call the appropriate event. So when it's pressed, we're going to set isPressed equal to true, and we're going to invoke the onPressed event. And then we're also going to add a debug statement just so that we know our code is working. And then I'm going to copy this, move it into the released method, and change the appropriate values. So isPressed will be false, and we're going to be invoking onReleased. And instead of logging pressed, we're going to log released. All right, how do we know when to call these methods? Well, in the update method, first we want to check to see if isPressed has not been toggled before. So we're checking for the case where the player has just pressed the button down, but we haven't registered it yet. So if isPressed is not true, and we also need to check to see if the button position is in the right spot. To do that, we're going to make a method called getValue, and I'll go over that in a minute, but we're going to use that value plus the threshold and see if it's greater than or equal to 1. And if so, we're going to call pressed. And then we're going to do the opposite. How do we tell if the player has just released the button? We're going to check to see if isPressed is true, and the value minus threshold is less than or equal to 0. And if that's the case, we're going to call released. So let's make this getValue method. The reason I'm doing this instead of just getting, you know, the difference in the values is because we want to actually be able to have multiple kinds of buttons and multiple sizes, multiple, you know, push depths, that kind of thing. So in order to do that, we're going to standardize the distance to a percentage. So the percentage is going to be from 0 to, well, actually it's going to be from negative 1 to 0 to positive 1 based on, you know, the spring pushed in or the spring released. But in this case, the dampening should prevent the button from getting, you know, pulled back out. So let's do a private. We're going to return a float get value. So inside of here, we're going to create a variable called value, and that's going to equal a vector 3.distance, and the distance between the start position and the current local position. So transform.localPosition. And then in order to get the percentage, we're going to divide that by the joint linear limit. We're going to call joint linear limit dot limit. And then we're going to check for the dead zone. So if math.abs of value is less than the dead zone, then value is going to be equal to 0. So if it's within that small number, it's just going to set it back to 0. And then we're going to return a clamped version of this, mathf.clamp value between negative 1 and positive 1. And that just prevents any weird numbers that pop up. There we go. And now we can test it with the pressed and released debug logs. So make sure to save your code. Let's go back into Unity. You'll see over here with the physics button now, we have a threshold and dead zone that we can manipulate. And then also we have an on pressed and on released event that we can add any kind of object or thing. So if we wanted to, you know, turn a light on and off, we can put the light object in here and then have it turn off or on based on if the button is pressed or released. You know, normal Unity event stuff. So let's hit play, run this, just go back to scene view, click over to console, and then when I push this down, push the push down, you'll see the released and the pressed. And then we can swap over to VR and try it with the physics too. And you'll notice that each time we press that, the console is registering the pressed and the released. So in the case that you add an event to this, the event will also get fired off whenever the pressed or the released happens. And from here, you can play around with the threshold. How much do you want the button to be pressed down? You can play around with the limit that we talked about earlier before the code and the dead zone, all of that kind of stuff. And this can be picked up, moved around. You can reposition it, turn it, rotate it, whatever. It's going to work exactly the same no matter what you do to it. So you can use this for doors, escape rooms, have fun with it, and let me know what you do with it. There you go. A working physics-based push button. Can I just say what an amazing support you guys have been? Since I've mentioned Patreon last week, I've gotten such an overwhelming support from you guys. This has been incredible. And on that topic, we are doing a Patreon live stream next week, and I think we're just going to do a private Zoom call. Small group of people. We're just going to talk about, you know, what projects you're working on, what projects I'm working on in the future, you know, a fun discussion for an hour or so. So if you're interested in jumping in on that, check out my Patreon, consider supporting. It would mean the world to me. And if you just want, you know, the source project, the project we talked about today or any of the previous project, it's all available there as well. And I want to give a shout out to the newest VIPs on Patreon, Ava and Jane. Thanks so much for your support. And Tim and Austin, your continued support blows me away. I am so appreciative of everyone on on Patreon. Thank you so much. And as usual, free of charge, I reply to every single comment on any of my videos. So if you run into any bugs or any issues, or if you just want to chat, just throw a comment out there and I will reply as soon as I can. And I'll see you guys in the next video.